Welcome to Retouch Pro Live, the only live talk show dedicated to retouching and post-processing. I'm your host, Doug Nelson. Thank you for being part of our live audience today. We'll begin our annual Halloween photo illustration show with Steve Caplin in just a moment, but first I have some announcements. If you are planning on uploading, and we appreciate those that have uploaded already, we've got a nice inventory for Steve to work from today, but you can continue to upload, and I will paste that link into the chat box right now. We have plenty of backgrounds and things along those lines, so if we're short on anything, it is actual objects, actual Halloweenish things, bats and pumpkins and things and cats and things along those lines. So if you've got anything like that you haven't already contributed, feel free to do it now as I continue on with the announcements. You'll want to see how to interact with Steve today. You should see this questions panel. If you don't see this lower portion here, click on the little arrowhead here, or it could be a plus sign depending on your operating system. This panel should drop down. Type your question or comment in here. Don't forget to hit send. We can't see it if you don't hit send. And we will use your questions and comments to guide the show today. And then when the after Steve's presentation is over, if anyone is still here, we can take some general Photoshop questions about anything, even non-Halloween things. Let's see here. I want to point everybody to the YouTube page for our shows because, first of all, we have several previous shows with Steve up there that will probably get referenced in passing today, and you'll want to know how to view those. And plus, today's show is going to have a million things in there. You're going to be going, what did he just do? That was fascinating. How did he do that? And your opportunity will be to go up, let's say tomorrow on YouTube, and view the recording of today's show. You can pause it and rewind it and things along those lines in case you miss anything today. I want to remind everybody that Retouch Pro Live is only available due to the generosity of our patrons. If you like Retouch Pro Live, if you've gotten any tips from Retouch Pro Live, if you want to see Retouch Pro Live continue, please become a patron. Got a couple comments in the last after the last few shows. Some people emailed me saying that they were surprised at how inexpensive becoming a patron was. I never mentioned the price. And so they just assumed it was like $100 or something like that, like it would be for subscribing to some of our competitors' sites. But no, it's only $25, and that'll get you a full year's patron subscription. There are a few perks to being a patron. You can read about them there. But really, those are just thank you gifts. Really, what you're doing is you're helping me pay for the webinar software and for the web servers and for the streaming fees and things along those lines. So please become a patron. Go to retouchpro.com/patron. I will paste that link in now. If you forget what the link is, you can just go to retouchpro.com, go to the site nav menu, click on it, and then scroll down to be a patron. And while you're there, check out some of the other links. I think you'll be amazed. I found out the other day we've got over 2 gigabytes of information up on retouchpro.com. And a lot of people are saying, there's nothing here. No, that's not the case. It's just I am crap at web design, and you have to search for it. I apologize for that. But there is a huge, huge, huge repository of information there about every phase of retouching, photo montage, photo illustration, photo restoration, 3D, photography in general. There's nothing that hasn't been touched on ad nauseum over at retouchpro.com. Okay. Steve Caplin is a photo illustrator based out of, shall I say, England? I always say Great Britain, but I always feel kind of pretentious saying that. But he's definitely out of England. He's still out of Great Britain, but it sounds a little less hoity-toity. He is famous for his How to Cheat in Photoshop series of books. You should really, really check those out. You can also visit him at stevecaplin.com and, of course, see the thousands and millions of shows that we've done previously here at Retouch Pro Live. Give me a second here, and I will switch over so that we can see Steve's screen.
There we go. Hi, Doug. How are you
there
doing?
There we go. Welcome back, Steve. Happy Halloween.
Oh, no, not yet. It's not until, you know, my local supermarket started selling Halloween merchandise on the 1st of September.
Oh, we get it in August. We get it in July.
Awful. I mean, you know, Halloween's all very well. But
as a matter of fact, now it's kind of hard to find Halloween stuff because all the Christmas stuff is starting to...
Yeah, exactly. So here we go. Yes, Halloween show. We've got so many extraordinary images.
Look at all these images. This is one of our best participated shows ever as far as user images.
Indeed.
And they're still coming in. This is marvelous.
They're fantastic. We're really spoiled for choice, but I think I'm going to start off by choosing a background to work with. So let's make our choice of background. So I really like this image here, but it's an indoor one, and you have to have an outdoor for Halloween. It's a fantastic image. I'll see if maybe we can use the floor from this.
I'm able to incorporate that in some way. You don't think that might not work for like a dance macabre kind of thing or something?
It might, but then, you know, you can't have a gravestone indoors, and you have to have gravestones at Halloween. So we're torn between, I mean, this one is it's very small. There's a problem with that. And also the composition is awkward because having this gravestone right in the middle means you can't really put anything else in the scene. So I'm going to go for this one here. This is a picture of St. Nahis, I can't quite see with that's an I or an L in there, which is apparently an 18th century church and something in Dundrum. Let's open that one up and take a look. Oh, it is nice and big as well. Perfect. It's a 18th century church and graveyard in Dundrum. I don't know where Dundrum is. I'm assuming it's in Ireland.
And I got to assume that's Nahl. I'm thinking it's Nahl.
No, it looks like an I on the end. I think it's an I.
Although St. Nahi is very attractive, very fun thought.
Yeah, certainly is. So a great image because we've got the gravestone, we've got a lot of sky. We can put a different set of clouds behind, and there's a good central area that we can start building our montages in. So first thing I want to do with this is to take out that sky because obviously we're going to want to have a nighttime view. So I'll double-click this to make it into a layer, getting rid of the sky. Well, the simplest way is really the magic wand. So I'm just going to click and shift-click to select, you know, more and more of this this sky and
you
cloud area.
You still use the magic wand in 2015?
Yeah, the magic wand. It's a great tool. And I know it's been there since forever, but it's it works really well, especially for things like this. There is all our sky selected, and let's just hit delete, and there it is gone. Now, there are some little bits of sky left within the trees, but we'll take those out when we've got another sky put in place here, just so that we can see what we're doing a bit more easily. But, you know, there is the sky got rid of. The magic wand, it's underrated. Other than that, the image I think is going to work really well. The only thing I don't like is this, what is this stop 9? I've been puzzling over the stop 9 down the bottom. You can see that next to the gravestone? Don't know what that is. I'm going to use my patch tool and just go over that and get rid of it. There we go. That's gone. Whatever it was irritating me. So,
I'll bet you James Burke is famous, and this is on some sort of tour, and this is stop 9 on the tour.
Oh, could be. Well, he kept going till 1977, despite the fact the gravestone looks... Oh, there was an earlier James Burke as well, and then Thomas Burke, and then even earlier James Burke.
The only James Burke I know was the television guy. I don't think this is him.
He was an English television guy. Now I want to find a sky. We're a little short on skies. I quite like
there's one
this one.
John Zorn's had one there.
These. He's
Yeah.
got some great skies, but he's put his skies behind. He's done these really nice montages. But of course, with the montage in front, it's very hard to use his skies. So I think I might have to go for. Oh, there we go. Where did that suddenly come from? Did you just put that in there?
No,
Was that from
been
you?
there all along.
It's great. I'll take it. Thanks, whoever put that one there, even if it's only you. So I'm going to take that, open it up, select all, copy, close, paste. Let's move it to the back.
Somebody
Bring
just
it up
commented in
here.
that John's montage was a PSD, so you could open it up and take the sky out of it.
Oh, was it? I didn't even notice that.
This is
I'm going to
actually looking pretty
squeeze
good.
this up because I make that more dramatic sky. There we go. And I think I'm going to just open up curves and strengthen up the sky. So it, there we go. Much that's nice. A more kind of nighttime, doomy looking sky there. That's pretty good. You like that?
I do like that.
I rather like that. So now we can get rid of all these bits of original sky showing through our image here. So, eraser tool, and I'm going to use the background eraser. And we've done a whole show, I think, on the background eraser. If we haven't done, we certainly should do.
We did spend a significant amount of time on it, but I don't know if we d dedicated a show to it or
A
not.
lot of it. Well, I'm going to go for sampling once, because if you go to the default is sampling continuously, and you erase stuff, you really don't want to erase that way. Protect the foreground color. So I'm going to sample this light green here. There we go. That's my foreground color, and it's going to click on the sky. Make sure I'm on the right layer. On the bit of visible sky, and then I can just drag all over this, and you can see how that sky very, very neatly now disappears from inside all these trees.
I like how you're doing a lot of this with old school tools. Magic wand, no layer mask, the background eraser. These are all things that have been available for 10, 15 years.
Well, they absolutely have. And usually, if I were doing a job like this in earnest, then I would probably use masks and make it more editable for myself. But we've got a whole show to get through in an hour, and
Or so.
I don't know if there's time to mess around with things like layer masks. So I'm just going to go ahead and push forward. There we go. That's the sky taken out, that's all right. Obviously, our scene here, it's a daylight scene. We need to make it into a night scene.
Now we did do a
So
whole show
let's.
on day for night.
We did, at least one. Let's go to our adjustment layers. I bring up a curves adjustment layer. I'm going to tell it to clip to the layer underneath so it doesn't affect the sky behind. First, I'm going to take out a lot of that brightness. I want to take out the green. Take that down, and quite a bit of the red. Now, tell me if this is looking too dark on your. There we go. That's not bad.
Still looking a little daylighty.
Well, it's looking a bit daylighty, but it's because of all the green. I'm going to fix that next. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to go to Image Adjustments and Replace Color. Oh, you didn't expect that, did you?
I certainly did not.
I'm going to sample some of this green. Hang on, I'm on the adjustment layer. Right. Image Adjustments and Replace Color. Sample some of that green, and I'm going to take the saturation down. I'm going to hold the Shift key, drag over it so I get more of that green sampled. There we go. You see, it's not so much the brightness as the strength of color that makes it look like it's daytime. So let's now drag this over to the right to make that green rather bluer. There we go. And now there's our nighttime shot.
Oh, it is nice. Looks like
Yeah?
nice bright moonlight.
And I think that works actually quite well. I'm rather pleased with that. So, having got that, our now sky behind looks
Where
a
those
little bit too
pink
much of a.
highlights come from?
They are not pink highlights, they were already there, we just didn't see it I think when, oh, you may think they weren't there?
I don't know.
No, I think they were already there. We just didn't see it with the contrast against the original. It looked fine in daylight. But pink, I don't mind. I'm quite happy with that. Let's make this sky behind. I think we might need to change the color of this. Let's give it a more of a bluey tone. That's going to work better. That's much better. I like that. Okay, let's move along. What else have we got we can put? In fact, I'm going to save this. I'll do a save as, and I'm going to call it. I'm not going to call it anything because it's come on. Oh, come on.
What's
There
going?
we go. And I'll put it in a Halloween. I'll call it Halloween 2015, just in case it crashes and we lose everything. At least we've got something we can go
Yes,
back
we
to.
actually,
So,
the last time we did a Halloween show, it actually did crash in the middle of the show, so that's good thinking.
well, that's the curse of Halloween, isn't it? Coming
Yes.
right up. Let's get some more buildings in here. This is a great building. I like that one. So let's see if we can tuck that in here. So I'll select this again. How am I going to select all that? Okay, first of all, I'll get rid of the sky here. So I'm going to go not for the background, but the magic eraser. And the reason for that is if I just click on that once, that should. Oh no, hang on, it's contiguous. I want to take that off. So it's discontiguous. That should now take out all that blue. Yep, inside there as well. Yep, it's taken out inside the railings. So now I can use the magic, the lasso, another old school tool,
I think you've set
and I'm just
yourself a
going to.
chair. How many old school tools can you use in today's photo illustration show?
Well, let's find out. Let's go. Where am I going to go up here? I'm going to go up the side of this building. I don't really care about what's happening at the bottom there because I'm going to hide that. So I'll take this. Copy it. Close this window. Don't want to save that. And now let's paste it in. There we go. So, and it fits, quite well up there. Actually, that's not bad up on
Might
the.
just want to shrink it down and make it a silhouette.
Well, not quite a silhouette, but we could certainly tone that down quite a lot. And one way we could do that, now this is something that sometimes works and sometimes doesn't work, but let's give it a go, is I'm going to make a selection of just a square in the middle here. Shift Command C or Shift Control C makes a merged copy, and I'm going to paste that up here. And I'm going to call this colors, which I'm going to put a U in just to annoy you. So that's just got our basic colors. If I now go onto the building, again, sometimes this works, sometimes not. I'm going to go to Image Adjustments and Match Color. And I'm going to select as my source this document, and the layer I'm going to choose is colors. And
Huh.
there we go. Ah!
I was not expecting that.
No, it's quite interesting, isn't it? As I say, it doesn't always work, and you can see it's rather, it's faded it out a little bit, but that's not bad. Let's go for that, and now we can use curves on here again just to strengthen that up, maybe darken it up the contrast. So, not quite a silhouette, but it's certainly blending that rather better into our scene. Let's now also take out a little bit of the red just in the brickwork there.
Getting a lot of comments. People really liked that trick.
It's pretty good, isn't it? As I say, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It's very often worth a try because it can save you so much time when it does work. Right, let's go back into here. What shall we put in? Well, we've got some fantastic, really fantastic images in here. I love some of these. I like this doll particularly, this ventriloquist dummy. Let's take him. So we'll select him, and once again, magic wand is very often just the quickest way to make this kind of selection. So I've selected all of that background, inverse that selection. I'm just going to use lasso to deselect some of these stray spots that are up in the corner that were darker. Copy, close that, and let's paste this in. So what are we going to do with this? I think because he's got the bottom half missing, we should have him coming up through a hole in the ground. But first, I mean, he's pretty good. I like the way he's looking, but wouldn't he look rather cool if we put maybe this kind of a face on him? So I'm going to select part of this face. So I'm going to use go to quick mask, and those of you who know me will know that whenever I use quick mask, I always set it to the color indicates selected areas and not masked areas. So now the where I paint will be where my selection is being made. So go onto the brush tool, soft edge brush, and I'm just going to paint over some of this face. This is a fantastic image. Who sent this one
Ted Eggs.
Oh, Ted Eggs. I know Ted. Hi, Ted. How are you doing? Good to,
And he's a British
well,
zombie.
good to see
This
you're
is
still there.
London Zombie Day. We don't have a zombie day here in the United States, I don't
No,
think.
I didn't know we had one here. But Ted, next time there's a zombie day, let me know and I'll come with you. So, gotta
Oh, that
copy
I
that.
want to see pictures of that.
Close this down. Yeah, indeed. And let's paste it on top. Okay, so it's quite small. It doesn't matter. We're going to shrink the whole thing down later. So, get this the right kind of size. That looks pretty good. And we can distort this a bit. Now, as you can see, the dummy is looking over to the right. But this figure is looking straight at us. What can we do about that? Well, before I click enter to apply this, I'm going to switch from regular free transform into image warp. And we did a show a couple of weeks ago just about this.
Yes, we did.
The advantage of that is in image warp, I can now drag the features over that way. So now our face is looking more over towards the side there. And there it is.
Quite a
Let's
dapper
add,
zombie.
it's not bad, is it? Let's add a layer mask to this. And on that layer mask, I'll just paint out, so under that hairline, maybe so we get some of the original face showing through in there. That's not bad. Let's bring the whole thing down a bit so those eyes
That
more or less
is
line up.
seriously freaky looking.
I'll take that as a compliment.
For Halloween, yes,
For
absolutely.
Halloween, I'm not
If
sure
this
I'd
was a
put it that way,
Christmas show, that might not be a compliment, but
but yeah, that's pretty good. Okay, so let's take both of those and make a group out of those. And in fact, I'm going to start giving things names. I'll call this dummy, dummy, zombie, whatever. So let's move that out of the way.
zombie.
So we want this coming up through a hole in the ground. And what is a Halloween view without a grave? So there are lots of ways of making a hole. Here's a quick one because we haven't got time to mess around here, so I'll make a new layer and I'm going to call it hole. And I'm going to paint a hole. So I'm going to go to a hard-edged brush, make it bigger than that, and let's go for we can paint it in any color. Something that's going to contrast, so looking for a bright pink. And I'm just going to paint. In fact, we can almost see there's a slight depression here as it is. So we'll paint like this. And it's, you think holes are round, but of course, when you're viewing something like a hole from the side, then it does really need to be more oblate, more flattened than round. That's something that people sometimes get wrong. That's
Particularly holes you've dug yourself from underneath.
exactly. When you're clawing your way up through them,
Yes.
there we go. So that is our basic hole. Now, how do we make this hole look more realistic? Well, first of all, we can put some texture into it. No, actually, second of all, before we do that, I'm going to go for the smudge tool. Again, a very underrated tool, and I'm going to choose one of these sort of spatter brushes. And these are a default brush in Photoshop. Choose a biggish one and make it even bigger. And I've got the strength here set to, well, just 50%. If you're using a tablet, it doesn't really matter, but 50 to 70% is pretty good. And I'm going to smudge up in the front. And that is bringing up strands of grass. Yep. And that is going to make this hole look quite a lot more Like it's got the grass, coming up in front of it. And again, at the back, I'm going to smudge down a bit, just so you get this little sense of overhanging grass falling into that hole. Yep. Now, at the moment, it's a bright pink hole. It needs to be obviously more of a brown hole. We could, we could make some texture in there, but let's see if we've got any texture we can take out of something someone sent in. Let's go back to our images over here.
There's some dirt
And
under the dog.
under the
Are you looking, is that what you're looking for?
dog?
Dirt?
Do you have dogs in your country?
I
I would
thought
call
that
that a cat.
in the thumbnail he looked like a dog. It makes more sense for him to be a black cat.
It does. I think I like this here. Look, in this one. I'm going to open this. And there, that's a nice bit of earth. So I'm going to make a selection of that. Thank you, James, for this. There we go. So I'm going to copy that, put this away, and paste it on top. And I'm going to make it big enough so it covers the whole of the pink area, and then just make a clipping mask of the hole underneath. Yeah? Okay, so at the moment, it's a mound of earth sitting on top of the grass. How do you make it into a hole? Well, you go to the dodge and burn tools. So let's start off with mid-tones, and that's going to darken up certainly the bottom here. And when you darken the bottom right away, that turns more into a hole. I think you'd agree. I'm going to also darken underneath the grass coming over the top, which gives it a little bit of a shadow there, so it makes it look like the grass is sort of pulling over that. And now change this to highlights, and I'm going to put some vertical streaks in here. And this is really the way to make this look much more like a proper hole, because you get the sense of it sort of accents the vertical nature of our hole. Yep, so some dark verticals, and then when you're using the burn tool, you can hold the Alt key down, and that gives you the dodge tool temporarily, and so you can build up the maybe it's a sense of I don't know a spade marks or digger marks or whatever you've got going on under there,
Claw marks.
and I think that's a bit more like a hole. It'll certainly be more like a hole when we put our dummy, let's change this to I pick up the group automatically, and let's bring him over the top and shrink him down. That's quite a nice size, and put him now. Of course, we want our dummy to be coming up through the hole. So, simple way to do that is make a layer mask. So let's put him back on here. I'm going to load up the hole as a selection by holding Command on a Mac, Control on a PC, and clicking on the thumbnail. And that's loaded all the pixels in that layer as a selection. I'm now going to inverse the selection, which is up there, Shift Command I, Shift Control I. So now everything except the hole is selected. I'm going to limit the selection to the bottom part of the image. So I'm just holding Shift and Alt, and that intersects a new selection with the old one. So now I've just got this bottom part in front of the hole selected. On the dummy layer, I'm going to go to Layer, Layer Mask, and Hide Selection. There we go. So now it's inside the hole. So we can pick him up and move him. Ah, but it goes horribly wrong. Why is that? Because the mask moves with it. We don't want the mask to move with it. So click on this little chain here between the two, and now we can move the group independently, and we can have it wherever we want, kind of, poking up through that hole. That's quite good, and I'm going to save. Okay, so there is our image so far. We could do with darkening him up a bit. Maybe we can just copy this curved adjustment. Let's try that. So hold the Alt key down, drag it above the group. Did it go? It didn't go. We're all the way above the group. There we go. And clip it to that group. Yes. Yeah, actually. Not done a bad job on that. It's toned that down a little bit. I think that's working quite well. So we need a focus in here. And of course, you know, one focus we need at Halloween is a skeleton.
Oh, of course.
And that brings us to poser.
Oh, yes.
Because poser is a great way to make skeletons. Now, so let's switch into
plus,
poser.
Plus, you know, on top of everything else, is it's one of the most scary pieces of software around.
It really is. It is. Okay, the poser interface came from Kai Krauser, he of Kai's Power Tools. And
a total
when
madman.
He invented this back in the mid-90s, it was a wacky and interesting and novel and absolutely innovative interface.
I'll go with you with wacky, but I will argue with you on the rest of it.
Well, here we are many years later, and they have never...
They haven't touched
or even, frankly, modified this interface. When you get used to it, it's okay. So it was very cute. You can see all. It's very skeuomorphic. So you've got this little virtual ball you can use to drag your thing around. You've got the face on hand, which is for panning it left and right, and you've got the sideways hand, which is for moving it forwards and backwards. And you've got these four little pointy fingers for dragging it around. It takes a lot of getting used to, and we haven't even started on posing the figures yet. So let's have a look at, well, this is the default figure. Why? I have absolutely no idea. Given that the whole point of poser is how good it is at modeling realistic looking people, why on earth they choose to start off with this bizarre...
I don't understand why Poser does anything. Literally.
No, it is a curious program. However, we can get through it. So let's pick a skeleton. So we open up Poser content, and here in the digital figures, oh, we've got a whole skeletons folder. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different skeletons in that folder. You think, wow, do we really need 6 skeletons? No, we need more than that. Because if you look at the anatomy folder, say that again?
Do we need our skeletons named Allison and Ryan?
The Ryan skeleton, the Allison skeleton, are named after the Ryan and Allison figures, and they're conforming skeletons. The reason for that is if you wanted to have your Ryan figure and you wanted to have him so his flesh is dripping off him and you can see the skeleton underneath, then you could do two renders.
That would be another show, though.
That's another show. We will come back to that because it's a good idea. In anatomy here, we've got, some more skeletons. These are rather weird skeletons. In fact, we're going to use those skeletons, but not yet. I'm going to start off with this male skeleton because it's a skeleton. So tick the little tick at the bottom here, and it says, do you want to... Yes, of course you do. That's why I said that I wanted to... Honestly, they keep on saying, are you sure you want to do that? Yes, of course, I'm sure. So here's our figure. Now, we've already looked at how we can move it around. How do we pose this figure? Well, there are three basic tools. First off is the translate tool. The shortcut is T for that. And when you grab an object and drag it, it'll move the limbs associated with it. So you can see as I move that arm around, then the elbow moves, the shoulder blade moves, and it's all really quite realistic. If I try and do the same thing with a knee, that's interesting, it's moving the knee, but the foot isn't moving. Why not? Because the foot is chained using inverse kinematics. Yes, you heard me right, inverse kinematics. So we can go and have a look, and we can say up here under figure, use inverse kinematics? No, don't use it. We'll leave it on for the moment. What that means is you can pin these feet. So what it means is when you drag anything above the feet aren't going to move because they are inversely kinematized or whatever the
That's not even a real word.
Verb is. It's not a real word. No, you picked me up on that, but hey, we can't have everything. I'm in a rush. So we can grab the feet, and as I move the feet, well, that figure's going to kind of move along
there
with it
go.
Quite neatly. The advantage of inverse kinematics is if we grab, say, the pelvis, and as we move that around, then those feet sort of stay as much as they can
skeleton
where they
tai
are.
chi.
It is. It's quite a nice thing. So we can get some quite realistic poses just by bending those legs a little bit. That's good. So the translate tool is your basic a bludgeon of a move tool. To move individual body parts, you want the rotate tool, and that rotates a part, so we can bring that arm up. You can also use W is the twist tool, and that will revolve. So you've got two, you've got the revolving it, and you've got the rotate, and you can see how these actually work in somewhat different ways. So if we wanted the head, we can use the rotate tool to move it up and down, move that around. If we want it to look side to side, we switch to the twist tool, and we can turn it with that. It does take a while to get used to, you know, how these tools work and what they all do, but there's only three basic tools you need to use, so it's not that hard to get your head around them, really.
I think the skeleton might actually be easier than the regular models, because the problem I've had with the regular models is whenever I try posing them, a lot of times the skin will ruck up unrealistically.
Yeah, if you, it's very easy to twist something too far, you will start getting nasty things going on. It's just a question of not pushing it beyond the bounds of anatomical possibility. So here's our hand. The hands start off very, very straight and rigid. And obviously you want to relax them. We want to use the grasp tool in here. So we can go to, but there isn't one. For some reason, on this skeleton, where it says other, that's where it should say, do you want to bend the hand? Because of course you want to bend that. I want to bend those fingers in. We could bend each of these fingers individually, but as there are 10 fingers with three joints on each finger, I'm not going to sit here and bend 30 separate bones.
Sure.
So what do we do? Well, what I'm going to do is switch skeletons. I'm going to select this male skeleton and change to this temporarily. So let's switch to that skeleton. And you can see it's going to come out in the same pose. Why didn't we use the skeleton to start with? It's a dreadful skeleton. Look how awful it is.
It's interesting looking.
The head is absolutely bizarre. The ribs have been created with no anatomical knowledge whatsoever. The only thing that's good about this skeleton is it exactly matches the male musculature, so that you can put the muscles on top of this skeleton, and then you can selectively hide part of the muscles. So this skeleton is not really designed to be used as it is. What is good about it is if I click on the hand, there, we've got that little hand pose. And now you can adjust, you know, each bit of each finger, or you can just, as I'm going to do, make the whole hand grasp. So I'll drag that across, and you can see that's now got its all those fingers bending down slightly. Let's do the same thing with the other hand. So select that hand and grasp. You can see it going more easily there. That's better. And you can do the same thing with the thumb. Bring that in a little bit. So that's not bad, and all I've done here is use this simply to give me access to the tool that should have been on the original skeleton in the first place. Got a quite nice texture on the skeleton, but hey, we can't have everything. So now I'll go back to our male skeleton, which, although it doesn't allow you to fiddle with a hand as well as you'd like to, at least it looks more like a skeleton. And with any luck, that should come back. Yep, there we go. There's our grasping hands.
Fascinating.
So a lot of time when you're using Poser, you have to kind of work around its, shall we say, idiosyncrasies for the sake of politeness.
It's pretty much designed of idiosyncrasies.
It really is. So what pose do we want for our skeleton? Well, we want it to go into our image. So let's go back into Photoshop and let's take this into Poser as a background. And the way to do that, we could just save it as a JPEG and take it in as a background, right? Wrong. We can't do that because this image is 5,579 pixels wide, and for reasons best known to whoever makes Poser these days, it won't accept images bigger than 4096 pixels wide. So what I'm going to have to do is do a save for web, and I'm going to save this out as a JPEG, and I'm going to take it down to, let's say, 4000 pixels. There we go. Save that. And that should now allow us to save it. We'll put it in here as a background pic. So there we go. That's saved. And now let's see if this works. Back into Poser. Go to Display. No, it's not there. No. File. Import. Background picture. Oh, no, hang on. So I slipped onto QuickTime footage. File, import background picture. And there it is, background pic. Let's bring it in. Do I want to change the window to match the background? Yeah, all right, I don't mind. That's what you want to do? You can do it. There we go. Why is only half the picture showing? Because we've still got our ground plane on view. So let's go to Display and hide that ground plane. And that is here under guides. You wouldn't guess unless you'd spent hours looking for it, as I have done in the past, and turn off that ground plane. And there's our image. So what we can do now is, let's say, well, I guess we want to have him interacting with this gravestone. So let's pan him across like that. That's not bad. We probably want 1 foot is on a slight hill there, so let's maybe move that leg around that way, maybe rotate that. In fact, we could even move some of those toes down so it's going downhill. That's quite neat. This one, I think we want to bring up slightly, and we can rotate it round. In fact, I want to put a twist on there. Oh, no, I don't want to twist because that's going to twist the wrong way. Rotate it round there. So now he's standing kind of uphill. That's quite good. This hand, it could be holding something, couldn't it? So let's maybe open that out. So to make this hold something the right way round, we want to twist the humerus and the ulna.
Now you're just showing
impressed.
Off.
And turn those around and then just bend that hand down like that, so we can put something in it. This hand, I think we could bring up and maybe drape over the grave like that, over the gravestone. And that's quite good. Okay, so there is our skeleton posed. Yeah, actually reasonably well.
Except we're still in Poser.
Still in Poser. Absolutely. We've got the Photoshop image as the background. So we could render this. Let's do that. We go to the render menu and just choose render, and that will load all the lights. I didn't even show you. We'll do a show about Poser sometime, and I'll show you how to do lights and how to set up rendering and whatever. The trouble with that is twofold. Firstly, it's rendering it on top of our background image.
Yeah.
And also, once we have the render, well, we can get the image into Photoshop, but it's going to be just this image. Since Poser is a 3D modeling program, why not instead go to File, Export, and export this as an OBJ file, as a 3D model. Here we go. And we get this little set of dialogues. Do you want to export a single frame or a multi-frame export? Well, since we only have one frame, I'm going to do that. There we go. Let's export that.
They can't even do a folder tree right.
No, exactly. They get things. So, okay, this is showing which bits you want. And do you want to have the left hand? Yes. Okay. Do you want to have the fifth? The fifth joint on the left finger? Yes. Do you want the fourth joint on the left? Yes.
We can
want
see
the third
the
joint? Yes.
We don't need
do you want
the
thumb? And you can see this goes on and on and on and on and on, and you can choose which bits. And, oh, let's make the dialogue wider so you can see the whole thing. Nope, you can't make the dialogue any bigger than this. So, you know, you're done over there. Oh, that's all the hand. Then you go back. As it happens, fortunately, we want the whole thing. So I'm just going to say okay. But this is one of the things about Poser, is it is so pig-headed. You know, it really makes things.
I think I understand why Kai hides out in his castle nowadays.
Yeah, exactly, as he does. So I'm going to say, okay, and now, do you want to weld the body part seams? Do you want to use fit? I don't care. Just give me a model. So I'm going to think, okay, and maybe a model. I call it skeleton.
I like your attitude.
Well, some things are just, you know, life's just too short. So skeleton, fine, skeleton. We've got a skeleton, good. Now, let's go back into Photoshop. 3D, new 3D layer from file. There's our skeleton. Excellent. We'll bring it in here. Now, one slight drawback is that Poser doesn't export OBJ files in a way that Photoshop is happy with.
Of course not.
So it's going to come in without any textures, but since there's only basic textures on there originally, that doesn't matter. It's asking what size I want.
0.55 millimeters.
A 0.55, half millimeter. Why is it asking me that? Because it thinks I want to 3D print it. I don't want to 3D print it. The 3D printing in Photoshop, yeah, it's actually quite good. But sometimes just give it a rest, okay? Don't ask me about that. I don't care. Just bring in the model. That's all I want is the model. Here comes the model. Ah, and there's our model. Not bad. So, switch to the move tool. And there's our move tool. Right. Good. So I'm going to switch temporarily into a 3D view of this.
Don't forget the grid throws off the webinar software. I don't know if the grid's even going to be visible or not.
No, I've hidden the grid.
Okay, thank you.
So we want that over here. We could, of course, you know, turn this around. It's a real 3D object. We can view it however we want, but since we did quite carefully pose it to go in here, let's put it here, so we're going to move it up.
I'll point everyone to, we did a whole series of 3D shows with Steve. They're all up on YouTube right now.
Indeed they are. So there we go. There's our figure just as we want it. Not bad.
He looks a little regal.
He's a bit lacking in texture.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you say? I wonder if anyone sent us anything we can use as some texture. Let's have a look.
I don't know about skeleton texture. Well, there is a skull there.
There is a skull. I don't think there's much we can use from texture. It's a bit of an engraving skull, isn't it? Maybe there's something on the floor, on the background there. Not bad. Okay. Well, oh, what's this? Oh, there we go. That's not bad.
Okay.
Right, let's use that. So we'll open up this one. I'm going to take a chunk of this and copy it. Good. So when we look at our model, these images here show you the various parts, each of which has a texture applied to it. So let's, for example, take the spine. We can go down to Edit Texture. And here is the texture. There's nothing in it. Let's paste our texture into it and let's stretch it to fill.
Now, if we would have selected that weld option in Poser, would this have come through with just like one skeleton?
No.
Ah, okay.
No, it wouldn't. For reasons, no. No, it wouldn't. Okay. Sadly, but you probably wouldn't want it to any, because you do want to have some degree of control over the various different textures. I'm going to actually duplicate this, desaturate it, set the mode to hard light. Darken that up a little bit, just to make it a bit of a stronger texture. There we go. Oh, by the way, if anyone out there is finding that they're really not following what I'm doing here, I'm not at all surprised. I'm really kind of rushing through this because we've got a lot to do in quite a short time. My only recommendation was, if you really get stuck, watch it again on YouTube. Or if you're already watching it on YouTube, pause, rewind.
Yes.
You know,
YouTube.com/RetouchPro, or just search for RetouchPro Live. It'll be at the top.
So let's save this texture. And when I close it, you can see, look, there's the texture applied to the spine, the rib cage. That's much better, wouldn't you say?
Yes.
Yeah. So now let's select all the other elements and we can say in their properties, let's change that texture to the one that we just defined,
oh,
which was
okay.
This one. Was it PH Skeletons text? I think it was. There we go. Much better?
Exceedingly cool. Very cool.
Exceedingly cool. Now, so why did I bring it in here as a model rather than rendering it over in Poser and bring it as an image? Because as a model, I can now choose how I want to light it. So click on the lighting. I can maybe have it lit from over here, and that's the way that most of this scene is lit. Yeah, from the side like that. That's quite good. If I were going to put a pumpkin down on the floor, well, I could then have it lit from down here. That's going to look rather nice. I quite like that. So let's leave that lighting down there for the moment. So this is one of the real advantages of bringing it in as a 3D model from Poser, is that you can not only move it around, but you can set the lighting exactly as you want it. And with something like this, it's the lighting that absolutely, I was going to say, brings this figure to life, but maybe that's inappropriate in this case. Let me save. So let's go back to our regular interface.
What happened?
And,
oh, there we go.
The selection of the skeleton of the skull was still selected. We're now off the skeleton, and let's put in, what should we have next? Well,
he
the skeleton
needs something
is,
in his hand. He said he wanted something in his hand.
He does. Let's go and see what we can put in his hand. Okay, back over here. But the spider in his hand, it's slightly from the wrong
give him
angle.
A pumpkin.
I guess a pumpkin. So, which pumpkin? We've got this pumpkin with a very remarkably shiny reflection for our pumpkin there. That's pretty good, actually, that
let's
one.
Let's do that one.
Let's do that one. I like this one. I would like it even more if there's only one of them.
That actually looks like a clone job.
It is. It is. It is absolutely. It's the same pumpkin repeated three times. One pumpkin. This one would have been great if there was one of them, but there's so we'll just use this pumpkin. So let's open up this. Let's take it in here.
From Evan.
So, magic wand again. Now, is the magic wand going to go underneath there? Probably not. So I'm going to switch to the quick selection tool and just add that in. That's going to give me a tighter.
We also did a whole show just on selections and all the various modifiers and shortcuts available.
Because it's a very white background, that's going to go into refine edge here. Let's have a look at this on a black background. Then you can see, yeah, you've got that white fringe around it. So let's smooth that a little. Let's shift the edge to bring that in to lose some of that fringe. And let's also decontaminate the colors so it should lose that fringe even more. There we go. It's going to be small. It'll be okay.
We also did a whole show just on refine edge. We've done a show on everything.
So let's copy this pumpkin and paste it in here. And we can put it in that skeleton's hand. So
it's a strong skeleton.
Skeletons are pretty strong, aren't they? They're even stronger, given that his arm isn't actually joined onto his torso in any way. So this is a skeleton with willpower. I guess we're going to need to carve a face in here.
Ah, okay.
Now,
instead of carving a face, is there a way to take an already existing, like a silhouette, and applying it as a face?
Except we want to cut holes in it. So unless we had a face, yeah, I could paste a face on the top of it. But
I didn't mean a face like the dummy's face or whatever. I meant like a drawing, like a pencil drawing or something.
Yeah. Have we got one?
I seriously doubt it.
Well, we've got a ghost.
Oh, there we go. kind of jars with the whole theme we were going
it
for.
It jars a little bit, so I'm not going to use that. No, yeah, the answer is yes, of course
spider.
We could have done that.
But use the spider as a silhouette and make a cutout of a spider.
I will, but reluctantly, because by the time it's on there, the legs are going to be so
Then never
thin.
mind. Then never mind. I thought it sounded like a good idea.
Well, I think we're going to have to draw a face. Unless, tell you what, this is your task. Someone out there, you've got 5 minutes to draw a pumpkin face, scan it or draw it in Photoshop and upload it. And whoever does the first one, that's the one we'll use.
Like a jack-o'-lantern type cutout face, just
That's the
the
kind of
eyes,
thing,
just
yeah.
the eyes, the nose, and mouth. We don't need the whole pumpkin, just the face.
Yep. In the meantime, I'm going to take let's take this cat, nice cat. Let's put this in. So make a nice quick selection of this. That's pretty good. Into a fine edge again. Let's give this a white background so we can see what's going on. And yeah, there's fur there, so I want to up the radius. And there we go. You can see that's bringing out kind of soft, furry edge on this cat. It's not perfect, but then in the montage, it will look fine. So let's take this, copy it, put that away. Let's paste in our cat. That's nice. I'll put the cat maybe down here. In fact, let's have the cat put that inside our adjustment layer, and that's going to fit in rather neatly. That's quite good. Now, to make things blend into a scene, we could have the cat just on the top there, and it's kind of okay, but it looks like it's plonked on top. My advice always in situations like this is to bring a background element to the fore. So let's leave the cat there. I'll just brighten it up a little bit so we can see it a bit better, and I'm going to set the opacity of this cat to just 50%. Because what I'm going to do now is make a layer mask. So layer mask reveal all. And on this cat's layer mask, I'm going to first of all use the lasso tool to take out all of this bar at the top. Select that. Fill that with black. The same thing along the bottom here, so all the way along this. And this is where I'm going to start cursing the designer of this grave for having shown off his ironmongery skills by producing this ridiculously complicated. Never mind, we can just go around each of these. He could have just used a straight pole, couldn't he? But no, he had to show, look what I can do.
It probably means something to Episcopalians or something. I don't know.
It, yes, maybe it does. These things often do, don't they? So there we go. So that's up that side, down this side, and I'm just desperately trying to think of ways of stretching out this sentence until I get all the way down to the bottom. But frankly, here I am painting. You can, people talk about sitting there watching
You
paint
can
dry.
just
Well,
make
here I am
random grunt noises and you'd be
painting
fine with
iron.
that.
Switch to the move tool, set the opacity back to 100%. Oh, there we go. That's not bad. So there's our cat neatly, back inside that. If you compare, there's the cat on the front, plonked on. Once you put it behind a foreground element, it just sits so neatly into the frame.
Which cats are wont to do anyway. Now, no
Which
one has
cats are wont to
uploaded
do?
an image yet, but John mentioned that one of his images has pumpkins on a layer that you can steal.
Oh, does it now? Let's have a look. Let's go back into here. Ah. Oh, of course, because these are actually PSDs. All right, let's open this up. There are indeed pumpkins there.
Ooh,
Okay, so
look at the one on the bottom right.
this one, you like that one?
Of course, I like that
Okay,
one.
we'll take that pumpkin. It's quite low resolution, but that's all right. So copy that. Oh, this is, oh, look, it's a before and after. There's his original. There's his night. Yeah. Nice, nice, good. So copy that. Let's put that away and let's paste it right at the top. Where's it gone? Oh, there it is. Okay, it's a little small. That's okay.
Yeah.
Let's bring that up.
Evidently, we've got another one coming. It's taking a while, though.
Oh, we haven't got time for a while. Who's making this one? Come on, you're quicker than that.
It's not their fault. It's Dropbox. They're slow.
Okay, we'll change the mode of this to screen.
Ooh, that don't look bad
Actually,
already.
it's not bad. It's really not bad. Well, we'll leave that there for the moment, but we'll see what else comes in. I think this is looking quite good. Let's take our building at the back there. I'd like to, I think, just darken that up a bit. Maybe take a bit more of the green out of there. That's pretty good. And I want to light up this room here. We've done day for night so many times, but I never get tired of it because it's just fun. There we go. So select the outside of that window, take out those glazing bars, and this one, the glazing bars, is that what they're, I think it's what they're called. I
Definitely
don't.
glazing. I don't know if it's bars or not, but
You know what I mean by glazing bar. That's that one. And we've got to, because this is the same room, I've got to do the one around the corner here as well. And that one and the bottom half of this one. So good. So rather than making those into a new layer, which you might think is the obvious thing to do, instead I'm going to make it into an adjustment layer. So with that selected.
Here's something for you. Eleanor points out that those are called mullions.
Oh, are they mullions? Well, the things between the windows.
I
Cool.
love doing this show. I love
That's
RetouchPRO
great.
Live
No,
so
that's good.
terribly,
Thank you for that.
terribly
I'll
much.
write this up. Let's add some lots of red into that and some green into that.
Ooh.
That's right. A bit more red. There we go. That's
A
brightened that
shame
up
it's
quite
not a
nicely.
bigger, a shame it's not a bigger window so you could get like a silhouette of something evil happening or something.
Oh, I'm sure we can. Who can we put in there? Silhouette's going to be. Well, we're going to have a ghost coming out of it. We could certainly have the ghost. We have to have the ghost in there because it's such a cute ghost. So let's select outside there, inverse selection, copy, and let's paste our ghost in. That's a big ghost.
Who are you gonna call? Ooh,
Actually.
yeah, I like that
Yeah, I think that they keep the big ghost just where. Yeah, oh, that's great. Excellent. What fun. Okay. We need, on our skeleton, we need to have some shadow underneath him. In fact, I need to darken him up a little bit. So,
Can't you just
going
like
to
turn
low.
on the 3D shadow or something?
I could, but then we'd have to try and. Oh, well, actually, yes, let's try it. Okay, back into the 3D pane. Let's select our skeleton, and our light. So we want to change the light. Okay, now this may work, it may not. Let's change it from an infinite light to a point light. Which we've now got to try and manipulate in 3D, and that's the
And
problem with.
you were a big fan of the way he looked already, so.
I was, but if we want to get the light on the ground.
You can just use an old school shadow. I'm sorry, I'm overcomplicated things. I've
No, no,
never
no, no,
done
no,
that
no, no,
before. That's so
no.
unlike me.
Let's try it.
I can see it there.
What I want to do is move it to the view here, and I want to move it that way, bring it up, and I think move it back quite a way.
I like that you can see it on the gravestone there. That's quite nice.
Yeah, that's quite good, isn't it?
Think lighting is the only 3D show we haven't done yet.
Yeah, you've asked for that, but it's lighting's a tricky one,
Yes, it is.
as you can see from the fact that this is so. This is very much too far from the front, so I'm going to push it back It's hard to control the light because you can't actually see the light itself. You can only
Yeah,
see its effect.
especially from an illustrative standpoint. If you just want like a realistic shadow,
I'm going to change it back to a regular light
yeah,
because this
yeah.
is a yeah. Okay, so
Plus, can you
where's
undo it to the
our
level so that he looks the way that he did, the way you liked him?
No, but it's easy enough to change it back to an infinite light, and then I can just move it down.
Still looks different.
There, that's quite nice, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
I like that.
Can't we you gotta remember to
And in
put a
fact,
we
what I
gotta
can do,
gotta
though,
remember
is
to
to
put a light
tint this
source
light.
there.
Let's tint it. Let's give it a kind of more of a bluish tint to the light, and that'll blend him in quite nicely. Yeah, you like that? There we go. So, we've got a bit of glow coming from this pumpkin, I suppose. So, maybe take the face and move it around the pumpkin a bit more so that it's facing him, so that some of the light is going to come out on him. In which case, the pumpkin itself, let's. I'm going to use Quick Mask again to paint my shadow area on the back of this pumpkin. Yeah? With
Okay,
me?
sure.
Now, out of Quick Mask, back into a selection, I can make a new adjustment layer. Let's use Curves again. Let's make it only apply to the pumpkin, and then we can just darken this up. Yeah, so that's given us our kind of pumpkin to be lit from the inside, but not at the back. Good. Let's load the skeleton as a selection and make a new hard light layer. So make a new layer. Change the mode of this layer to hard light. Fill with a hard light neutral color, and use the previous layer to make a clipping mask.
Well, you've checked
So
every box there is there.
I've checked all the boxes. When in doubt, just tick everything. It's like, you go to a restaurant and you have a burger and they say, you want gherkins with that? Yeah. You want fries with that? Yeah. I want everything. Just bring me the whole lot.
Or, as
No.
we call it here, American style.
Exactly. So what I am going to do is inverse my selection and delete. So now our hard light layer exactly matches that skeleton. What I can now do is lock the transparency of this hard light layer. I'm going to pick up a color, maybe not quite as bright as that, maybe this sort of deepish orange color from here. A soft-edged brush, I can take it down to about 20% opacity, and I can paint in, I can get a bit brighter than that, though, a little bit of glow. There we go. A little bit of glow from the pumpkin on our skeleton here.
Very cool.
Well, it just brightens him up a little bit. Maybe that's a bit too yellow. That was just pure white. Too strong there, I think. So, but the eraser, regular eraser tool, and just erase some of that. It's not doing it. Oh, no, it's not doing it because
Down the
I
layer
set
man.
the lock for transparency. So I'll use the smudge tool instead and maybe just smear some of that. There you go. So it's got a bit of highlight underneath the skull. That's the way to do it. Good. What else haven't we got in yet? Let's go back to our image. Our image is back. We've got a spider. Oh, we've got a web. Let's take the web. Always like a good spider web. Select all, copy, close, paste. Let's bring this well up to the front. I guess it wants to be on here, doesn't it? So make it bigger. Actually, I'm gonna. Yeah, no, that looks pretty good. Stretch it right down to the bottom here, and change the mode to screen. There we go. That's quite nice. I think maybe a bit of perspective on there might just make this look a bit more like it's belonging inside here. Maybe reduce the opacity a little bit, maybe down to about 50%, 40%. That's
Seems to
quite
be
nice. We can.
the it seems to be opposite. It seems to be brighter at the bottom. Maybe that's the way it's supposed to be. I don't know. But it seems to me it should be darker. No, never mind.
What are you saying? There's shading on this
Yeah, I was saying that
web?
it looked like it was it looks like a lot brighter at the top than it is at the bottom, and I was thinking that it should be flipped, but then again I was thinking no, not necessarily, so.
I'm sure we've got a spider expert out there who's going to tell us exactly what spider web should be like.
And arachnophobe. Ooh.
Let's take this one. So select all, copy, paste. Now we've got, it's quite a dark spider, and we've got a background that is not pure white. So that's going to brighten up the whole thing, I think. And let's put that on there. Change the mode here to, I guess, multiply. No, that's not going to
Look,
do it,
raise
is
him
it?
up a little, raise him up a little bit. It might be okay.
Well, I think what I'm going to do instead is use a bit of advanced blending.
Ah.
Hand me the forceps, nurse. So here we go. Double click this and layer style. We've looked at this actually not for a couple of shows, so everyone's looked at the layer style dialog. What most people never look at is this blend if section at the bottom, because blend if gray as an instruction doesn't make a lot of sense. And what it does is it controls the visibility of this layer depending how bright it is. So here we want to take out all the brightness. So let's drag the brightness down. As you see, as we drag it, you can see more and more of that background disappearing. Yep.
Okay.
It's a very harsh cutoff between what's visible and what isn't. But if you hold the Alt key down, you can split this into two, and you now get this nice soft fade between what's visible and what isn't visible. There we go. So there is our spider. In fact, we can now darken this up a little bit, I think. That's quite good. He's got a bit of a fringe to him, but then sometimes that doesn't really matter. Let's put him on top of his web. Maybe, I suppose they go right in the middle, don't they? Let's put
I
him
don't
in
know, are
there.
you asking? I don't know. I know zero about this kind of thing.
No, well, that doesn't matter. That's okay. I was just vaguely curious. It bothers me that the face on here doesn't match the dummy. So I'm just going to bring up my curves a bit and brighten that up.
We do have some spider experts in the audience. Sarah says only female spiders spin webs, so we already know what the gender is of that spider.
Is that right? Only female spiders spin
Are
web?
you going to argue with Sarah? I'm not going to argue with Sarah.
No, certainly not. Well, okay. I'm impressed. What else can we put in here? Was we still don't have a another pumpkin face, and we're running short on time. What have we got? I like this woman here, but I can't see a way of easily getting her in. Maybe we can put in a bit of a ruin. Let's go for this. Oh, we've got some more cobwebs there. Oh, that's one we use. That's the one we use, of course, it is. A bit of this ruin, I think, up in the background. Now, this is a kind of tricky one because I can select, with a magic wand, most of that sky at the top. But what I can't do is use it down here. So what I'm going to do is inverse that selection and Shift and Alt, or Shift and Option, will limit a new selection to the old one, and I'm just going to wiggle my way down because this kind of broken stone, no one really knows exactly what sort of shape it's supposed to be because it's broken. It could be any shape, frankly, that you want it to be. But it's a nice bit of masonry, so I can go around that. There we go. So I've got that selected, copy it, put that away. Let's paste that in. Over on the side here, maybe have it leaning back slightly in the distance. In fact, maybe put it all the way behind everything else there. That's quite good. Should we try that matching technique again and see if that works?
Okay, yeah.
Image adjustments and match color, and we want this image and we want the layer called colors. You know what I always give these demos and I say, make sure you name all your layers.
This is the first time
Look
you've
what
actually
I've done
it.
It's I've named one, two layers. It's horrifying. There we go. And it's matched it quite well.
Sure.
It's okay. I'm quite happy with that. Yeah. Good. There's probably more images we could squeeze in, but it's hard to. I tell you, I like these things so much. We've got two really beautifully decorated pumpkins in here. I think I've really got to get this one in. So let's see if. Okay, Photoshop is doing its thing where it's not letting me use any of the painting tools, and that includes the quick selection tool. So I'm going to go back into
kick a whole layer
here for a minute and see what else I can fiddle with. One thing that's bothering me a little bit is the fringing that you can see around this background image. You see that there? Slight fringe. I think I'm going to see if I can get rid of that by just using layer, make sure it's selected first, layer zero, yep. Layer matting and defringe. And I think a 1 pixel defringe might just get rid of that. You know, it's making no difference whatsoever.
So your strategy is just to do something else for a little while and then go back to that other one and then it'll let you paint?
There you go, that's done it. Yep. And now with any luck, if I go back to that image, there we go. That's fine. So I don't know what it is that upsets it and stops it working. I do know that if you just ignore it, you mustn't give in to these things. Just say it's like having a toddler having a tantrum. You don't give it too much attention. Just say, all right, fine. Come back when you've got over it, and then it comes back when you've got over it, and it's like everything's working again. Little hint on childcare there for you as well, Doug.
Don't forget the stems. Well, they don't let me around children anymore, so.
don't forget the what's?
The stems on the pumpkins. His horns.
Oh, is that what they are?
I assume it's the stems on the pumpkins.
I thought it was a bit of wood in the background. I'm not going to get the eyelashes because, yeah, all right, there's two of them. It will take too long to get the eyelashes, so that's fine. Take out a bit of that and just into there. Let's see how this works as a selection. Actually, not bad. Not bad. Smooth it off a little bit. That's okay. And it's got a little spike coming out the left. Did you notice that one? Deselect that. Copy. Put that away. We don't need that one anymore. Put that away. And where should we put our pumpkin? Maybe right down here in the foreground. This is a very bizarre pumpkin.
I like it.
Let's have it just down here. And we need a bit of shadow on it. Okay, I just want a quick action that I made to make that hard light layer that that I made manually earlier. And here, I'm just going to darken this up.
I think this photo montage is turning into an Adult Swim show.
It's certainly getting a little weird. Let's go down to our background layer, make a new shadow layer, and I'm going to name that one black brush. 20% is good. So a bit of shadow underneath the pumpkin. We need a little bit of shadow underneath the foot there, a little bit underneath the hand, and I guess a little bit just underneath that the back of that cat there. This is being lit from the left, so I guess we want a bit of a shadow of our dummy. Let's bring that across there. And are we done?
That's up to you.
I don't know. I think. Well,
is there a square centimeter that we can squeeze something else in?
Let's go and see what we've got. It's a shame to have all these great images and then not be able to use them all.
I want to do. We need to do a part two where we do that ballroom scene. I wanted to see like a skeleton dance in that ballroom or something.
The ballroom is great, isn't it? Let's do another one. Let's do another show. We'll talk about a bit more about Pozo and we'll go to that stuff. It's tricky. I love the cutout images. The objects are great when you have these completed scenes. There's some great scenes, but I can't really see
Down
how
at
to
the bottom,
incorporate.
Halloween on the Steens, there's an excellent moon. Can you put steal that moon and put it in there?
It's a PSD. Let's see what we've got in. Oh, look at this. We've got everything in here. We've got everything. That's fantastic. Okay, so Horse in the Sky, layer 13. You should always name your layers, don't you know? That's what I always do. Now, that layer 13 is actually. What's that? Oh, that's nice. I like that.
Cute, yeah.
I'm having that. And what's this one? There's our moon. Okay, good. So that's our moons. I'm going to grab that and drag that moon up into our document. Let's move it right down the back here in front of the sky. Oh, look at that. Isn't that lovely? So change this to screen. It's coming up behind those clouds somewhat. That's rather good. It's
It was
quite that
almost
part.
too easy.
It was, wasn't it? Maybe take the saturation down on that bit. It blends in a bit better and knock that hue up to a bit more of a blue.
Ooh, that's nice.
That's quite good, isn't it? And oh, where's it gone? I really like this. I don't know what it is, but I like it, so I'm going to grab it.
Some
It's
sort of
just a
lens
kind of
flare thing.
thing. Let's bring that right up the top. Come on, all the way up the top. There we go. I don't know what it is, but it's good. I'm going to stretch that the full width of.
That's from Greg Ambrose.
Thank you, Greg. That's really cute. In fact, I might move it back. No, I'll leave it at the top. I think it just gives it a bit of interest there. We could do maybe a little bit of mist swirling around.
Okay.
Let's do some quick mist. I make a new layer, mist. So how do we do mist? Well, first of all, I'm going to set foreground black, background to white. Layer a filter render. And let's render some clouds. Okay, that's all tiny, little fiddly detail of clouds. I'm going to take a small section of our clouds, maybe like that, and delete everything else. So there's our clouds. Change the mode of our clouds to screen so the black disappears. Stretch it out. Bit of perspective on there. That's quite nice. Okay, and it going to curves, pin the midpoint and increase the contrast. So, yep, that down a little bit there. That's quite good. And now just use the eraser tool and stop that. Going all the way up at the back there, so it just fades off. So we only got a bit of a mist in the foreground.
Maybe soften it a little
Instant
so we don't
mist, and it works, doesn't
can't see the cat anymore. Maybe just don't get rid of it. Just soften it a little bit.
Yep, okay. In fact, the way to do it then is just to darken up
There we
around the
go.
cat. And in fact, if I select that pumpkin, there we go. As a selection, still on the mist layer, I can now darken the top so the pumpkin just has its
Okay.
face peering out of the top of that mist there.
Very,
What
very
a quick
cool.
way to create mist, though, isn't
It is. It's wonderful.
it? It just kind of
You
works.
could even like you could like have the skeleton's knee pop out from the front of the mist and
I
still
knew you
have
were going to say that. I absolutely knew you were going to say that.
Well, it's
That's
because unfortunately it makes sense. It's the way mist works.
so rather than erasing it, I'm going to darken it. There we go. That's coming out, and the other leg as well. It does make a difference, doesn't it?
Yes, it
Gives you
does.
that sense of perspective there. Let's go back and see what we've got. I would have liked to have used. James has given us some really nice mist here, but if it had been photographed against a plain black background and in focus,
Now, see,
then
that
we could
would
have
look
used
really
it.
great as on the floor of the ballroom.
It would look great on the floor. This is another show. The ballroom will come later.
Trouble is our next show isn't for 2 more weeks, and that's after Halloween.
Well, sometimes we just have to put up with these little disappointments.
So is that it? We're going to save these images, and we're going to have a haunted ballroom show in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I think we can do
With
that.
more on poser.
Let me check my diary. But would you call it a calendar? You would call it, I think you'd call it a calendar, wouldn't you?
Yeah, diary is what little girls write down their secret thoughts and crushes
Yeah,
and
you know,
stuff.
you see, in the UK, a diary is what we would use for forward planning rather than for retrospective
Oh, that's
reflection.
right. The little girls in England journal, don't they?
No, they still diary, but it's the same diary. They just use it for a slightly different purpose.
So what? You have to be like Tom Brown to journal or something like that?
I think you really do, yes. You need to have more serious thoughts.
Okay, so pending your availability in 2 weeks, we will do the haunted ballroom with
Yeah, let's do that.
maybe we'll do dancing skeletons, maybe we'll bring in musical effects or something. We don't know what we're gonna do.
That would be
Marvelous.
great. And we can see if we can bring the skeletons and pop up with their flesh dripping off them. A kind of post-Halloween, falling
Okay,
down the earth thing.
we're gonna all of the images that were uploaded today, you're gonna have to save. Don't do it right now, okay? But after the show today, you're gonna have to save to a separate. Tell you what, I'll take care of it,
You take care of it.
because we're having a different, completely different kind of show this Saturday, where everybody will be uploading completely different types of images. And it won't behoove us to get them mixed up. And then whenever we're done with that, and we come back in 2 weeks, then I will restore these images, and we can pick this up where we left off. I don't know. Maybe we'll throw in a cornucopia or something, give it a Thanksgiving theme or something.
Excellent. Can I just say thank you to everyone who has contributed such fabulous images? And I know that from some of them. So there was this fantastic picture here of all these horses. And I looked at it and I thought, I'm going to take that moon, I'm going to take that. And I didn't look at, everything else. It's a really great montage,
In
isn't it?
retrospect, it turns out that this is the image that he was suggesting for us to use for the pumpkin. Evidently, that middle skull face pops out,
Ah, of course.
or perhaps the horse. I don't know,
Anyway, back on. So that's what I said. Thank you to everyone who sent in
this has
these
been one
images.
of the best contributory shows we've ever had. We could just keep on. As far as I'm concerned, we could do Halloween shows for the rest for all time. It's my favorite time of the year, and I really enjoy this. Do you have any final thoughts before? Don't forget to hit save, by the way.
Oh, I'll say,
Do
there we
you
go.
have any final thoughts for today?
Well, just to say, I know I have, again, rushed through this at a tremendous pace, mainly because, I wanted to try and get as many images in here as we could.
Sure.
There are loads of techniques I've used, and I know I haven't fully explained them, but watch it again on YouTube, just slow it down. I give some hints as to what I'm doing.
Sure.
If there's anything that doesn't make sense, right into Doug, we can do another show that
We
explains some of
actually
these concepts more
have a
fully.
dedicated forum thread just for today's show. I will paste that link in now. And if anybody has any further thoughts, or somebody had a recipe for hamburgers that included beets, that evidently we were talking about styles, and that's New Zealand style, is their hamburgers come with beets, and I've never felt sorry for New Zealand before.
No, I can't
Well,
imagine
no,
that.
actually I did. Those blasted big bugs they've got, those big weta bugs, I feel sorry for them for that as well. Let's see here. So we've got that in there. I want to remind everybody, if you want to see, I'm going to hold the skeleton ballroom show ransom. We want patrons. If you want to see that show, no, I'm not really going to hold it for ransom. But just to let you know, if you want to see more shows like today's, please become a patron. RetouchPro.com/patron. All of Steve's shows are available up on YouTube, YouTube.com/RetouchPro, or just search for Retouch Pro Live Caplin. Got to throw Retouch Pro Live in there because, face it, I don't know why, but he has made videos without us. The traitorous wretch. Actually, he's got some real funny stuff up there. So, all right. Well, thanks, everybody, for the uploads, which were marvelous.
They really were. They were fantastic. Some fabulous images.
Photo compositing aside, there was just some wonderful images in there. And images of wonderful things that would have been wonderful even without the images, like that pumpkin, for example. That was marvelous.
Yeah.
But I think we're going to call that at least done for part one of our Halloween, now our Halloween series. So in the meantime, I will see everyone in the forums. Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye, Steve.
Bye-bye, Doug. Bye, everyone, and thanks again.
Happy Halloween, everyone.